Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. I am minded this morning that this committee would like to express their solidarity with the people of Ukraine and wish for a speedy and peaceful recovery to the precarious situation that they find themselves in at the moment. We will move to our first agenda item, and this is UK in a Changing Europe and the Regulatory Divergence Tracker. Our first agenda item is an opportunity for the committee to hear more about the UK in a Changing Europe and the Regulatory Divergence Tracker, and we have welcome to committee this morning Professor Anand Menon, Director of UK in a Changing Europe, and Joelle Rilland, Researcher, UK in a Changing Europe. Can I welcome you both to the meeting? And if I could start off with a couple of questions. Could you give us your perspective on how the UK government is choosing to exercise its regulatory autonomy following Brexit? And also, which policy areas do you think might be most suited to regulatory divergence?
Do you want me to go first, Joelle? I mean, choosing is quite a heroic way of putting it, I would say, in the sense that there is so much. Well, firstly, you've had COVID getting in the way, so there hasn't been the kind of structured, well thought through process of figuring out what we want from divergence with the European Union. Secondly, I think the politics means that actually choosing a path is very, very difficult for this government, because on economic policy, the Conservative Party in Parliament and indeed in the country is a very, very broad and internally contradictory church. So, you know, there's been no sort of clear sort of setting out of a direction. There's been a lot of rhetoric, contradictory rhetoric. And what I would say, one of the great paradoxes about divergence and the European Union is this. You know, for those of us my age, you can think back to the Euroscepticism of the early 90s in the Conservative Party. That was a Euroscepticism founded in the belief that Brussels overregulated, that if we could cut free of that regulation, we could make ourselves a more dynamic and more competitive economy. And the point of Brexit was to get rid of rules. It was to make ourselves a properly competitive capitalist economy in a way you couldn't be inside the European Union. The irony is, having left the European Union, what we have become is a sort of high-spend, high-subsidising country that has made use of our freedom from the European Union to keep precisely those regulations that the Fresh Start group and others had always banged on about. We haven't got rid of working time, we've kept the environmental regulations, all those sorts of things. But we've got a new subsidy regime that allows us to give more money to industry. So in a sense, we've left Europe to become more French. So there are sort of paradoxes inside this. Now, I mean, clearly, in terms of areas for divergence, and I'd say two things. Firstly, there are those areas where, absent EU membership, we had to do something. So agriculture, we don't have the common agricultural policy. And to be fair, and let me just say in parentheses, or actually not in parentheses, given who you are, our divergence tracker is about essentially UK-EU. We're very, very well aware that there are UK internal market questions hiding behind a lot of this. And actually, we have plans afoot to supplement the divergence tracker going forward with some more specific considerations of the internal market of the UK dimension. But if you take agriculture, and I understand for you that one of the big issues about agriculture is the devolved aspect. But if you'll forgive me and let me just talk about the sort of UK-EU aspect, we are doing things differently. And, you know, God help us if we can't put in place a better agricultural policy than the common agricultural policy. I mean, anyone should be able to do that. And, you know, what Michael Gove first defined and what DEFRA is putting in place now, there are some encouraging signs that this might actually be a more sustainable agricultural policy tailored towards what we have in this country, if, and it's a massive if, they do it right and if they fund it properly. OK, the other obvious area before I hand over to Joelle, actually two more points. One is immigration is the obvious area where we have diverged because we ended free movement. We have a new system in place. All sorts of interesting things can be said about our immigration system. One, how liberal it is for non-Europeans compared to what went before. Two, how UK public opinion has shifted dramatically on immigration since the referendum. And actually, you know, for the first time since the early 2000s, for the first time since those days when New Labour were busy blurring the lines between refugee asylum seekers and migrants and making the debate a total mess, that immigration isn't a salient issue in British public opinion anymore. So there's been lots of interesting shifts in how the UK public see things. I mean, if you think about it, you know, 2017 and 2019, we had two general elections when we didn't talk about immigration, which is unheard of since the first years of this decade. But certainly in England. I see the chair doesn't agree with me, but we can squabble later. The final thing I would say is, in terms of divergence, what the government is setting out quite reasonably, I think, is the biggest opportunities come in new areas of economic activity where we don't have lots of regulation already. Fintech, AI, robotics, gene editing. They're areas where the British government hopes to be able to move first, attract investment before the EU gets around to acting. And it's not unreasonable, though the one thing I would say is there's precious little evidence as yet that doing this will compensate for the negative economic impact of leaving the single market and the customs union. Gerald, shall I hand over to you?
So I think just to supplement what Anand has said, obviously agree with everything he has said. I think if we're thinking about, you know, the fundamental thinking behind what the UK government is trying to do in terms of divergence, I think from our research, it's kind of the impression that we get is that it's somewhat scattergun at the moment. If you were to look, and the best illustration of that is the benefits of Brexit document, which came out a couple of weeks ago now, which is a 100-page list of almost everywhere that we could do something differently from the EU. It's highly aspirational, but there's no clear sense of how you might make the most of regulatory freedom. And that's how you end up with a situation where, on the one hand, you've got a government that is trying to, you know, increase the size of the state in terms of a new subsidy regime, agricultural regime, specifically in England there. And then on the other hand, you have the Treasury, which is looking to kind of deregulate and make a kind of lighter touch architecture around financial services. So these things don't seem to fit together. And the underlying implication is that, yeah, the government doesn't have a particularly clear strategy of what it wants to do. Another illustration would be the new Brexit Opportunities Minister inviting Sun readers to write in with their suggestions. Reportedly, you know, lots already coming in. That's not necessarily a good way for civil servants to make the most of their time in terms of passing what might be a good opportunity. So that comes back to saying, effectively, when thinking about divergence, business in particular would appreciate if it had a clear direction, because business is very clear that it takes 5, if not 10 years to adapt the new regulatory regimes, new rules. So they need an idea of what's coming, and they need clear goals to work towards. It also helps if across departments you have common goals, because then policies tend to fit together and you don't end up with a situation where, on the one hand, you know, you're pursuing a new emissions trading scheme, you've got net zero goals, and on the other hand, the Treasury is cutting fuel duty on domestic flights. These things don't seem to have any internal coherence. And so that kind of, yeah, again, illustrates if you want to make the most of divergence, you want departments that are all singing from the same hymn sheet, and that also helps business in its preparation. So then, just to address the second question, where can it go? Where are kind of the biggest opportunities? Again, I would agree with Anand. I think emerging sectors are the obvious answer. And again, I would point to the Treasury as the one department that has a clear idea of what it wants to do with divergence. It was faced after Brexit with a very clear reality that financial services would have less access to the European market in terms of equivalence agreements. But it's made a very clear decision, which is we're not going to try and get close to the EU. We're going to kind of keep that distance and try and make the most of that by becoming, as they would say, a more competitive environment. We're going to remove EU solvency regulations, which should make, you know, some of the kind of bookkeeping processes a bit simpler for financial services. And we're going to go, you know, in that direction. And again, innovation around fintech, regulatory sandboxes to try and encourage innovation, that kind of stuff. That's a clear direction of travel, and the sector can work with that. And so that, I would argue, is a model which could be transplanted more widely across government.
Thank you. My apologies. I didn't mean to not have a good poker face there. I was surprised. It's not my experience. I'm sure some of my members will comment on that. But it was just in the context. On Tuesday of this week, the Scottish Parliament rejected the LCM on the Nationality and Borders Bill. So that's the context I was thinking of, discussions and how much immigration features and what we're doing. So I'll move on to questions from the members, and if I could invite Mr. Ruskell first, please.
Yeah, thanks very much. The tracker is a really useful tool, a really useful summary, I think, for policymakers. And yeah, exciting to hear that you want to overlay some of the Internal Market Act and devolution aspects over the top of that. I wanted to ask you about one of the things that's highlighted in the tracker, and that's around financial services and greening finance and the development of a UK taxonomy. And just get your perspective on where you see potential divergence or alignment sitting within the EU or maybe with other countries that are developing their own taxonomies. I mean, I'm obviously aware that within the EU there's been a very strong debate about the inclusion of gas and nuclear within the EU's taxonomy. Do you see an inevitable alignment there, given that we face similar energy challenges across Europe, or do you think there's a different tilt, a different perspective with other countries that might end up getting wrapped up into some of the trade deals that the UK is looking to set up? So, yeah, not sure who wants to go on that first.
I can go first if you want, Joel. I mean, what I would say is... It's far from. I wouldn't take it for granted that the EU comes up with a united dance on this going forward or anything. At the moment, they fudged it. They fudged it quite effectively. I mean, one of the things the EU has become very good at over the last year to 18 months is papering over differences very, very effectively. I mean, it seems, even if you look at Ukraine at the moment, there are real divisions between member states, but they're managing to keep going otherwise. The other thing is, I mean, I'll go back to what I said right at the start, is there is, as far as I'm concerned, and Joel knows these areas a lot better than me, so I'll defer to him, but it strikes me that there is just a fundamental ambiguity about governmental ambition in this country. That you have rhetoric firing off in different directions. There's no, as a rule of thumb, take divergence seriously when it's driven by the Treasury, because they at least seem to have a plan. As Joel was saying about financial services, anything else, you will find evidence of cross-departmental squabbling, of different parts of government going off in different directions. And the picture for now is so blurred, I'm kind of reluctant to hazard even a guess, to be honest. But Joel's a lot braver than me, so he might.
What I would say is... So on the specific question of nuclear and the green taxonomy, I my guess is as good as anyone else's here. I simply don't know what the exact thinking, where that thinking is going to end up. But what I would say about the green taxonomy is it's a good example and quite a unique example of where the UK and EU are moving at the same time, which is quite unusual when looking at divergence. Normally it's either the UK is either because it has to now that we've left the EU, or because it's chosen to, is creating new regulations, or the EU is doing likewise. But here they're both moving in the same direction. And it will be a very interesting test case in whether there is a desire to kind of, a move in sort of lockstep and have almost like, mutually assured the opposite of destruction in this case, that we're going to do the same thing without really saying that we are, and that just makes life easier for everyone. Or we're actually going to, push the boundaries of what each other is able to do and try and get ahead, try and become, whether it's Amsterdam or London becomes sort of the center of green finance in Europe and potentially the world. My instinct is that the Treasury is thinking more towards that latter scenario where it can get ahead just for the reasons that I said before, that it's got a very clear idea of what it wants to do with divergence. And a lot of the rhetoric coming out of government ministers in that area is that it really thinks it can get ahead of the EU because we are one country rather than 27. And so I would not be surprised if we see gaps opening up in terms of green finance taxonomies in the coming months and years.
Okay, and that's interesting. And in terms of how that taxonomy is interpreted within the devolution settlement within the UK, across Europe, where you've got sub-state actors that are looking to invest in particular technologies, I'm wondering if you've got any thoughts on how that might play out. I mean, obviously, you know, we're meeting in Scotland today. We've got vast renewable resources. If you were to devise a green taxonomy for Scotland, maybe creating a financial centre for green investment in Edinburgh, you know, what would that look like? Can that exist within an EU taxonomy that's perhaps tilted in a slightly different direction or emphasises other technologies over others? Don't know if you've got any thoughts on that.
Can you just clarify? I wasn't not 100% certain what you're getting at.
So the point is how do we, can I put it simply then, how can we maximise the opportunities for green investment in Scotland to create a focus here, utilising the resources and the advantages that we have here in terms of energy under a taxonomy? Is there a potential for some divergence or emphasis in Scotland under a green investment taxonomy in the UK?
I mean, I'd say two things. I mean, firstly, this is way beyond my pay grade, so it's not an area I sort of specialise in. But I mean, the second thing I would say is that there are two phases to all of these questions. The first is how you regulate to encourage investment. The second is having attracted that investment, whether or not you are able to trade easily with the European Union. I mean, this is the rub with divergence, in a sense, is that it's all very well saying, okay, we're gonna create rules in such a way as to make us a leading centre for X. And take gene editing, okay? The British government wants to liberalise the rules. We want to be less bound by the precautionary principle than the European Union. The logic being that will attract inward investment that won't go to the European Union because you can't experiment as easily with gene technologies in the EU as with the UK. That's fine. You might attract the investment, but that investment only really comes to fruition if subsequently you can trade those products with the European Union, who happen to be the largest market on our doorstep. So one of the things that is absolutely missing from the UK government's sort of considerations of divergence and the benefits it might bring is that trade-off, which is if you diverge, you might make investment easier to gain, but trade harder to do, which will play back into investment decisions. The final thing I would say about that, of course, is divergence is always, in many cases, going to impose costs in terms of the UK's internal market with regard to Northern Ireland. Because, for instance, if you keep going on the issue of gene editing again, if we change our regulations and if we diverge from the European Union, it might well be that we are manufacturing goods that cannot be legally sold on the market in Northern Ireland because of the protocol. So I know that was a very vague and generic answer for the reasons I gave you, which is this is not an area I'm an expert in. I don't know if Jill wants to have a punt as well.
Trying to read that across maybe to renewable energy, and maybe there's an approach there. But Joel, do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah. So one thing to add is, I would say, impression of divergence so far is, and I'm sure you'll be aware of this, there's kind of very little sense of, you know, communication or coordination between the four governments of the UK and trying to create kind of the example that you're illustrating of, you know, perhaps that Scotland would be the centre for one aspect of a new regime and Wales, Northern Ireland would be the centre for another. That to an extent is probably an inevitable challenge of the fact that the UK hasn't had to do its own regulation for 50 years. Like the European Union has, to a large extent, set, you know, the processes for how we regulate. And so we are sort of a nascent country in terms of having to actually regulate things again. And so there are a lot of processes which still need working through, and much as it's going to take business 10 years to adapt, it's probably going to take government 5 or 10 years at least to adapt to working out how to do that effectively, especially given, you know, the political sort of sometimes clashing dynamics between four governments as well. And so one interesting aspect will be, you know, the review of intergovernmental relations and how kind of the new councils and things which have been set up, how they work in practice. I know there's been some tentatively positive commentary about how it might foster better relations and better working processes, although incidentally the Interministerial Committee on Finance seems to be potentially by more problems than the other committee. So that might be attention, particularly on green finance. But yeah, I think it's incumbent upon ministers in all parts of the UK and also officials to make those things work properly, because it's going to rely on a lot of political goodwill to make that stuff a success.
Thanks. And just final question about European Union emissions trading scheme. I mean, I think you say in your tracker that you expect the scope of that to be significantly widened. Again, do you see the UK just falling into that same kind of scope, or do you think there may be tensions over, you know, over aviation or other areas?
Okay, I'll just go again. I think the biggest tension will be over kind of the carbon border tax, which is the secondary element to the emissions trading scheme. They kind of tend to work hand in hand, and we know the EU is developing plans in that area, and that seems like not so clear that the UK is necessarily going to follow on that area. So that's where I potentially see the bigger element of divergence emerging on emissions trading. I think broadly, for the time being, the EU and the UK are thinking in similar ways about it. So I don't expect major elements of divergence, although, you know, there may be some nuances as these things mature over time, because they're both very new, and there will be some needs specific to the EU, which likely we won't necessarily want to replicate here. But those, yeah, I would expect largely to move similarly. It's the carbon border tax element, which is potentially more sensitive, a more dramatic move for the UK to make, and largely might depend on who is in government, I would say.
Okay, thanks.
Dr. Allen?
Thank you very much. You alluded, I think, to the experience, perhaps, of businesses trading goods. Well, you certainly talked about how Brexit hadn't really simplified regulation from the point of view of, I think you were talking about trade there, from the point of view of businesses who found that regulation might have been multiplied or at least duplicated. I wonder, can you make any observations about the Scottish Government's intention to attempt to keep pace with regulation in Europe, and what the impact of that might be, whether there's any areas that might be fruitful for the Scottish Government, in your view, to concentrate on to try to minimise that experience of duplicated regulation or complication from the point of view of people trading goods?
Well, I mean, the first thing I'll flag it up and let Joel talk about it. I mean, the key examples, I think, at UK level, I mean, we focus very much on UK level rather than Scottish Government. We'll try and talk about Scotland a little bit, are probably the CE mark, where the UK government had talked about bringing in its own alternative to that and has delayed that, partly, I suspect, because of pressure from business, and also chemical regulations. To date, the government is facing an awful lot of pushback from business for diverging. So it might be, and this is where it ties into Scotland, I wouldn't be at all surprised if at the end of the day, the UK government diverges far less than early rhetoric suggested that they might do, because pushback from business is saying, look, this will add so much in the way of cost to us. So it might be that Scotland has less work to do, in a sense, in remaining aligned, because London is doing it anyway. So it becomes less complicated in that way. I mean, that's a guess. And of course, our politics is nothing if not massively unpredictable at the moment. And I think, you know, the identity of the occupants of Downing Street is going to have an enormous implication for the future direction of travel. But the signs at the moment for me are that, having talked tough on this sort of stuff, the British government is slightly backing off the idea of widespread divergence in this sort of area, because they're becoming more aware of the costs. Joel, do you want to?
Yeah, so just say I absolutely agree that UKCA, the marking, which is you know, replacing the CE mark on a manufactured good when it comes into the country in order to be able to circulate on the British market. So this new mark is you know, it's creating a lot of, I don't need to explain in detail, but creating a lot of extra bureaucracy for businesses to get everything reapproved in some product areas. We're looking at, you know, it might take 60 years to get every product restamped. So it's a big headache for business. And that's why things have been delayed. And also chemicals regulation The UK is trying to set up its own architecture, but it takes time and it's simply not able at the moment to move at the same pace as the EU. So you risk sort of some element of divergence by default in the meantime, because the EU is regulating on more harmful chemicals than the UK is able to keep pace with. The challenge for Scotland on both of these is, and admittedly, I don't know every fine grained detail of this, but it doesn't immediately appear obvious to me how you could allow Scotland to keep greater pace, because these seem to be things which are done at the UK level. I may be wrong, and this may be something that you would want to go away and look into, but those are the two most obvious examples for the time being, and I don't see quite how Scotland can mitigate the most significant effects of it, and it's somewhat reliant upon the UK government rowing back on, as Alan said, its earlier commitments. The most obvious area at the moment where Scotland does have an element of autonomy is agriculture, in terms of developing its own agricultural policies, gene editing, the new Office for Environmental Protection. I know that England has its own one, and Scotland will be developing its own one. And so those, to me, are the obvious places where there's grounds to keep closer to what the EU is doing than England is, if that's what Scotland wants.
Thank you.
Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested in divergence in the field of climate and environment, and I think it's an incredibly interesting report that you've produced. I note that you say in that report that, in theory, Brexit could make it easier to enact policies for reaching net zero. Now, I realise we're at an early stage of this, but can you indicate what the early evidence is suggesting in terms of the UK's approach to divergence from the EU in terms of target setting and mandatory commitments to help to tackle climate change? Who would like to come in first?
I'm happy to go.
Sure. Yeah, okay.
So there's very little divergence. This is coming back to what Alan said right at the start, is, you know, we've left the EU to become more French, more European, and almost more European than the Europeans when it comes to climate change, because ambition at the moment is higher even in terms of, you know, the ultimate pace of getting to net zero than it would have been had we been part of the EU's NDC. So there hasn't been that kind of, you know, there's been no backsliding or moving away on that level of professed ambition. And largely, when you look at what the UK is trying to do at the moment in terms of getting there, it made mentions of Brexit and the net zero strategy, but there's very, very little which, you know, required, if anything, that required regulatory autonomy to move there. So for the time being, there's no major indication of, you know, a different strategy outside of the EU that may change with time. And that's more what the comment meant, is, you know, in theory, there is, you know, we have the autonomy to change, you know, VAT on certain products if we so wish, that we didn't have before. And so those are kind of tweaks around the edges which could be made. Potentially, you might want to use state aid subsidies in future. The example that's always referred to is gigafactories and putting money into these factories for the development of, I think it's solar panels. And so the new subsidy regime may enable that, but again, we're still very much in the theory rather than practice stage of that one. So there are those opportunities if the government now or in the future chooses to take them, but for the time being, level playing field, really.
Wow.
Yeah, I'd go along with that.
Yep.
Sorry, I'd go along with what Joel said. I mean, you know, at the moment it's very, very hard to say. I mean, I understand there's a weirdness about Brexit, isn't there, which is all we've talked about since 2016, and yet I'm going to say it's very early days. And, you know, we've just got to live with that paradox, because the government hasn't had a chance to act. At the moment, it's hard, you know, the government talks a good game, but everyone knows that this is a very, very performative government that is good at sending out signals and as yet has been less good at actually delivering in practice. And, you know, actually, again, you see that playing out a little bit with the rhetoric over sanctions on Ukraine and the reality of our sanctions as compared to the EU's, when actual action was necessary. I suspect, again, that we will cleave quite closely to the European Union for all the rhetoric about the fact that we're doing stuff first.
Thank you. That's very interesting. And I think some of your analogies can be applied up here in Scotland as well with respect to climate change narrative versus delivery. I just wanted to specifically ask you about the UK's nationally determined contribution, which is highlighted as a 68% reduction in carbon emissions by 2030. And the EU's target is 55%. Now, in the impact assessment of this, there is an indication that while being part of the EU wouldn't have stopped putting this more stringent target in, it would not have been able to present it in the same manner, if you like. And I just wondered if you could perhaps expand on that. And I note there's a number of other examples where the UK's striving ahead in order to tackle climate change on oil and gas boilers, more sustainable agriculture, on petrol and diesel cars. And I would just be very keen to hear comments on that. We'll start with Professor Anand first this time.
Yeah, I'll say something very general because Joelle is the person who actually knows something. In general terms, and more or less across the board, what the EU does in regulation is it sets baselines. It sets baselines for the member states, and member states are absolutely at liberty to go further than those baselines suggest. I mean, that's true when it comes to rights, and it's true when it comes to environmental targets. So as far as I'm aware, there was nothing in EU law that would have stopped us saying we're going to do this by an earlier date than EU law mandated. So, you know, it might be, you know, what the argument you get from some Conservative MPs in Parliament is, yes, that's true, but actually this is given as a sort of added incentive to prove ourselves. So actually there's a sort of political will element to this that is built in because we've left that wasn't there before. I mean, you can agree with that or not, as the case may be. But as far as I'm aware, there was no legal strictures that would have stopped us doing this as a member state of the European Union.
Thank you.
Absolutely agree with that. It was the main benefit from having the UK's own NDC was the symbolic element, particularly in the run-up to COP26, in the sense that it allowed, you know, the UK to say, we have got this 68% target, whereas had it been an EU member, it perhaps, you know, would have had to sort of repeat the 55 line, in the sense that that's the sort of unified position, albeit it could have been pursuing exactly the same goals as we are pursuing now outside the European Union. So it's that purely symbolic element of being able to talk about something, the kind of the perhaps diplomatic leverage you get out of that. There's an open question as to how well that was used. And it just comes back to that point that kind of the benefits that we're seeing in climate change policy are, for the time being, still very much in the rhetorical sphere. It's about being able to say we're signed up to a new, you know, British target, or we're going to create a new British agricultural system, which is going to be greener, you know, public, or not British, actually, that's specifically English, but public money for public goods. These kind of, you know, sort of rhetorically, we're moving differently, we're moving faster than the EU potentially, but really the fundamental issue is that we haven't seen the delivery yet, and we don't know whether government is actually going to be able to deliver on what it's promised. And that's where the real test of making use of regulatory freedom is going to come.
Thank you for that. I think you're quite right to highlight actually setting the ambitious targets is the very much the easy part of tackling climate change, and the delivery is when things come home to roost, as we are seeing. So thank you, panel. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Mr. Golden, can I invite Ms. Pinto?
Sorry. Thank you, convener. Thank you, panel. I've got two specific questions on the report, the tracker that you have provided. On migration, I'm interested in the when you did your introductory, you were talking about the importance of robotics and the investment in this country, and how research and development and that could be sold on. And I'm just wondering how that ties in with no longer being an Erasmus Plus scheme and the new tutoring scheme, given that Erasmus Plus also kind of supported inward students, so a different and improved university experience, but also supported research and also lecturers as well, so giving a wider experience in universities, colleges, and then also allowing for wider research, and how that, you know, ties in with the situation that we have.
I'll say a couple of things on that. I think actually in terms of the sort of R&D base, Erasmus is far less important than Horizon. And Horizon, of course, is being held up as a function of the ongoing uncertainty over the protocol. I have absolutely no doubt whatsoever that the Commission is using this as a political weapon. They might deny it, but the fact that there's been no decision yet on Horizon is linked to what's going on over the protocol. And that really matters. And that has got the scientific community exercised, and rightly so, because access to those research networks is really quite fundamental to the future of British science. And if you want to be that sort of leading knowledge economy with the leading university sector, having that access is absolutely fundamental. On Erasmus, I mean, it's as much sort of cultural as it is scientific, Erasmus, in the sense that you get people who come here, have experience of living here, might come back and settle here, and things like that. Erasmus was always an interesting thing when discussed in UK universities, because, certainly English universities, where I have experience, because we tended to get far more students than we sent. It was always a bit of a struggle, my experience, to actually getting the students to go over there, and there was always a bit of an issue because we had fee questions and they didn't over in their universities. But I mean, you know, I think it's a separate debate, it's an important debate, and you can add to that debate the other part of the cultural thing is the British government's decision, rising decision, I think, not to recognise EU identity cards, which is having a calamitous impact on school trips this country. And there again, on the cultural side, I suspect that's something that's going to have serious medium-term implications, because those kids are simply not going to come and see this country and have an experience of it.
Thank you. Joel, do you have anything to add?
Anand largely covered the points I was going to make. I think just a slightly broader reflection, no problem. Gave me some words. A slightly broader reflection just on divergence is that when we look at this tracker, we are trying to identify, we're obviously limited in what we can do, we try and identify what we call significant cases of divergence, and broadly, you know, we measure that in financial costs, we measure that in new non-tariff barriers, other administrative costs for business, for citizens. Erasmus/Turing is an interesting example of what's more culturally intangible. And these things are, by definition, very difficult to measure. And really, one of the most challenging aspects of divergence to keep track of is what it means in terms of people-to-people links, in terms of just the kind of sense to which the UK is tied culturally to its neighbours. And that can have very serious implications down the line if things are lost. I think you look at, you know, students who come to the UK are much more likely to remain here, to come back to invest here, to take holidays here. So there's all kinds of elements which, you know, ostensibly if we were doing a divergence tracker now, we wouldn't say this cost has happened from the loss of inward student movement, which is not in the Turing scheme, but it could be a very significant effect. And this is, potentially there are going to be more areas like this which we simply haven't come across, because, you know, Erasmus is a high profile issue, which we talk about a lot, but there may be others out there, and that is a challenge for everybody in this sphere.
I think that's a really good point. We've taken evidence about the importance of soft connections that you have, and certainly the cultural side is one of these. And just also thinking about the diaspora of a country isn't just the people who've left, it's the people that have come and perhaps gone away again, but will still keep coming back and continue these connections. Which kind of moves me on as well to kind of the recognition that the different countries within the UK have got different needs And that's been highlighted through the kind of Freedom of Movement Act. And as the convener touched upon, we had a debate in Parliament about the Nationality and Borders Bill this week, which the Parliament rejected. And also in December, there was a joint letter sent to the Home Secretary from the Scottish and Welsh governments raising concerns about that. So I just wonder if you could expand a bit more on the research that you've done with regard to visas in specific areas. I think you highlighted HGV vehicle licences, HGV drivers, I should say, but also, you know, health boards as well certainly are crying out for staff. Also vets and hospitality, so really all spectrums, and how we can move forward with these areas.
I mean, the moment you introduce control, you end up with a system that is less responsive to economic need. And that's what we've done. We had a system where there was no control. And of course, the lack of control itself was a political issue, as we saw in the referendum, but it was more quickly responsive to economic needs. So it's whatever system we put in place, it's going to be clunkier than a system via which people from your nearest neighbours, because geography matters as well immensely here, were able to come and fill gaps in our labour market. There is obviously in Scotland, we did a conference the other day on British politics, and Kirsty Blackman was on a panel, and she said, I don't know if it's true or not, but it stuck in my mind, that given ageing populations in Scotland, even if every single school leaver went into the care sector, there would not be enough care workers because of the gaps there. So we have a need for this, and the new visa scheme doesn't address it necessarily that well, in particularly lower paid sectors. Whether the government bends on this going forward, we just have to wait and see. I mean, the signs over HGV driver licenses was, yes, there is some flexibility in the government position. Whether longer term they decide, look, we're going to have to put something more structural in place for those professions, particularly things like social care, healthcare, that come below the wage threshold, I don't know. There's an awful lot of pressure on them. And the health unions are already making it perfectly clear that, look, you can't train enough people for those positions, and besides which it will take, you know, it takes a long time to train a doctor. At the moment, I think the bottom line is politics is dominant when it comes to immigration, and it's politics rather than the economy that is taking precedence in the thinking of the government. Whether that situation remains the case going forward, I just don't know. But there is a mismatch now, and it's an inevitable mismatch of moving from a responsive system with no controls, where actually the inflow of labour is largely determined by the market, to a new system where the inflow of labour is determined by political and bureaucratic rules.
I think that's an interesting comment and comparison, given that some of the arguments that we hear about the reason for the EU exit was economic ones, and yet... So I'll leave it there. Joel, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, I think, firstly, I would absolutely agree with Anand that the biggest challenge is going to be in terms of that lower paid work is where I think the biggest gaps are going to be going forwards. But just as you're saying, there is a certain irony in the fact that we expect net migration to the UK to remain sort of in the hundreds of thousands for the rest of the decade. This is not taking back control of borders, is not about cutting off the borders. And I'd also encourage you, if you haven't, to read our report on doing policy differently after Brexit, which we published about a month ago now, which has a chapter on migration, and which makes quite clear that the UK outside of the EU is going to have one of the most, if not the most, liberal regime for non-EU migration in Europe. So there is potentially greater avenues for people from the rest of the world to come to the UK than there are for them to go to the EU. But the challenge remains that, you know, there is an estimate that maybe 50% of jobs in this country would be eligible for a visa based on the skills and pay requirements. But nonetheless, you need the money to pay for a visa, and you need to be, you know, these aren't necessarily going to be some of the more low paid jobs in society. So the type of migrant that you're going to get coming to the UK is going to fundamentally change. And so there will be different diaspora, which brings with it its own potential cultural benefits, new links. But yeah, the type of worker is likely to change. And in particular, sectors like the care sector probably aren't going to benefit much. They are going to be probably net worse off, or not probably, they will be net worse off from the new regime which is coming in.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I wonder if I could just ask a supplementary, because I'm finding the conversation quite fascinating in terms of visas. If we look to what's happened previously, prior to Brexit, Scotland had a post-study work visa. So you were talking about Erasmus not being an economic value, but the post-study work visa was incredibly valuable, incredibly important here. It was initially adopted and rolled out across the UK and then scrapped, but retained for two, for Oxford and Cambridge universities. So I guess there's a sense of, I'll just say it, grievance in Scotland as to how that arrived at, and that's there. And also from what you've said about, you know, this was all about, you know, building a free capitalist economy, is also the decision of the government to last week shut down the investor visa route with immediate effect, which could limit, you know, capital investment. And is that counterintuitive to what the you know, the stated aims of Brexit would have been?
Well, I mean, I'm not going to sit here and try and pretend that we have government policies that are coherent across the board, because we don't. And of course, in regard to the sort of investment visa, that's got to be viewed in the context of what's going on in Ukraine and enormous political pressure on the Conservatives over links with Russian money. So, I mean, it's a whole, you know, events, as Macmillan said, are driving this rather than anything else. On the post-study work visas, I take your point about the grievance. I also take your point about the economic importance of those things. My understanding is those things are back for some categories of people. So I believe that Indian students in the UK as a whole, if I'm not mistaken, can now make use of this post-study work visa. As a result of which, ironically, there's been a massive uptick in the number of Indians students in this country. It's been very underreported, but I think it's trebled or something. There's some enormous eye-watering number. Actually, if you're interested in this issue, I'd strongly recommend that you have a session with our colleague Jonathan Portes on the sort of immigration and migration issues. But actually here, there's a curious sort of tension in the government's position, which is that they understand the economic value of having students here, as you can see in the case of the Indians, but deny it in the case of Europeans. So there are, you know, there are clear tensions in the government that, you know, this isn't consistent or coherent across the board, but I think that's just called politics.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to invite Mr. Cameron, please.
Thank you very much, and very, very struck by those last comments about the difference between skilled labour from non-EU parts of the world and in contrast to the EU. Can I ask about the pace of divergence? I was very struck by your comments so far about the fact that we seem to be moving very slowly. We've obviously had COVID, and we've had to move in some areas. There's the opportunity to take advantage by being proactive in other areas, such as financial services. Do you see divergence speeding up in any way over the next few years to come?
I think the answer to that is political rather than anything else, in the sense that it depends what happens to the UK government and the UK governing party. I think, you know, what are the scenarios? The scenario is you continue with the Boris Johnson government, in which case I don't actually expect, I expect a lot more fudge and not much more divergence. A lot of rhetoric about Britain doing things first and best, but without much. If you get a more ideological Conservative leader, then yes, you could get more divergence and more of a plan to sort of implement the kind of deregulatory agenda that was laid out in Britannia Unchained. I don't think it will go as far as that, but I think this is very, very politically driven. I think if you ended up with a Labour government, you would end up with greater alignment. I think Keir Starmer has said he would sign an SPS agreement with the European Union. I suspect they might sign a mobility package with the European Union to allow service providers to travel. They might go for more in the way of mutual recognition of qualifications. So I think that this is ultimately in the hand of politics. And if there's one thing that's unpredictable at the moment, it's politics.
Joel, do you have any observations?
Yeah, just as usual, totally agree with what Anand has said. But I would just add on top of that. So basically, divergence takes time. There's no quick way to do it. Even if you want to deregulate, even if you want to get rid of existing EU legislation, you have to consult on it. You have to then design processes for it. You have to implement the systems to remove regulation, and you have to get business prepared for them. And so you're looking at several years before you can even make a more light touch regime in a lot of areas. Examples at the moment would be medical device regulation, or that's I think the best example at the moment actually. So deregulation takes time, and for that reason I cannot see there being a major shift towards it, because fundamentally governments are fairly short-termist in what they try to pursue. They have 4 or 5 year mandates, and so they don't have the time to pursue reform which really will take 2 parliaments to do properly. So I can't see it being across the board deregulation. Even if we were to have a very ideological prime minister coming in, I would expect it to see it perhaps more in some areas, but I don't think we'll ever see major deregulation. Where divergence can move quickest is in terms of where you can make the most changes is in terms of limiting some of the obstacles which have been created, and sort of more where Labour to come into government, I would expect to see more quick fixes to some of the bigger problems that businesses are facing, which the government now might feel ideologically sort of unable to address for their own complex reasons.
Thanks for those. I mean, it goes back to something I think Anand was saying earlier about the it's a very blurred picture, and about one of you was referring to sort of cross departmental sort of arguments and that kind of thing. I mean, it strikes me that that's the nature of politics. There's always going to be internal sort of arguments across the civil service. There's going to be different personalities, etc. I mean, without being too depressing about it, do you see any, setting aside the political drive at the top, do you see anything, any clarity emerging on divergence, in the years to come? Are we going to be, notwithstanding all very helpful tracker, are we going to be sort of feeling our way for many years, it seems to me?
I think we are going to be feeling our way for many years, yes. I mean, it's partly administrative as well as political. I mean, we have to wait and see, I suppose. I mean, the way I'd put it is whether Jacob Rees-Mogg is a policy maker or a policy taker. So there are two broad models to the Brexit Opportunities Unit in the Cabinet Office. One is that, he acts on the basis of this reportedly 1,200 letters he's had from Sun readers about regulations they'd like to get rid of. And the Cabinet Office starts making the weather here and saying to departments, look, this is what you need to do, and the authority of the Prime Minister is behind me. The other model for Brexit Opportunities is that Jacob Rees-Mogg essentially just takes credit for stuff that other departments were going to do anyway that are based on our divergence from EU law. And we don't know yet. We don't know how that unit will operate, whether it's going to be sort of symbolic or substantive. And so much of it does hinge on the basis of leadership from the top. You're absolutely right. Interdepartmental rivalry is part and parcel of government. But interdepartmental rivalry can be mitigated if there is a clear steer from the centre. And one of the interesting things about Jacob Rees-Mogg's appointment, of course, is that his rhetoric on tax and on regulation is very much that of one side of the parliamentary party, but it's far from all of the parliamentary party. So even there, how free he is to pursue the agenda that he clearly has is something that, I mean, if you ask us back in a year's time, we might have some more clarity. But at the moment, I just think it's very, very hard to say.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can I ask just one final question, which is about the impact of commitments that the UK has in terms of international obligations, and the fact that the ability to diverge may be impacted by those international obligations, be they in the TCA, WTO agreement. Where do you see the booby traps, as it were, coming in terms of international obligations affecting divergence?
Could say that the TCA is far from the only international obligation. I've put in the chat, and I'm not sure if members can see the chat, a link to a report called Doing Things Differently, Policy After Brexit. And I just draw your attention towards the section on public procurement in there, because that points out very clearly that actually one of the reasons why, despite very high ambitions, we haven't diverged that much from the European Union in terms of our public procurement rules is that those rules are derived from WTO rules on public procurement. So there are numerous areas. Auto standards tend to be global. So there are a number of areas where actually this isn't a question of freeing ourselves from the EU rules and being able to do whatever we want, but it's freeing ourselves from EU rules and finding that actually we're still bound by other international commitments we've signed up to as well.
Joel, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah. The other area that's going to become more of a factor in future is future trade agreements. You can already see it in terms of what's happened with Australia and New Zealand, and there have been tensions around what it's going to mean for certain food and environmental standards. Ultimately, those haven't shifted significantly, but there are likely to be implications around financial services and liberalising agreements for movement with Australia, and that has then potential knock-on effects for your wider financial services architecture. And that's going to come again. It's going to come with visas, going back to Anand's point about sort of visas for Indian students. And there was a geopolitical tension there with number of visas given to Chinese students. If you try and do agreements with other countries, there's going to be, I'm sure, visas are going to be raised as a factor. So that has knock-on effects for your immigration regime. So every time you try and enter a bilateral, enhanced bilateral partnership with a country, they are going to want to extract things from that relationship, which has knock-on effects for your wider regulation in that area.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much. It's been very interesting being able to read the tracker and also the work that you've been doing. I wanted to pick up one of the issues about lessons learned from other neighbours to the EU. You've got the EFTA network, which has been going on for decades. I'm just wondering, what are the lessons that the UK can learn being a neighbour of Europe, but not now being in the EU? Any lessons from the other non-EU neighbours of the EU in terms of the economy and divergence and trade deals?
I mean, I'd say two things, I think. First is, if you are a neighbour that doesn't want to join, it's a bit of a nightmare. That's the first lesson, is it's very, very hard to be next door to the European Union unless you sort of pledge allegiance and say that ultimately you want to be part of the club. Switzerland has suffered as a result and is suffering as a result in the negotiations. Norway's had far from a smooth ride. I'd caution that. I mean, I've always, and this is a purely personal belief, thought that the sort of EEA model works fine if you're a small country. For the UK as a whole, I was never convinced an EEA model would work for the United Kingdom, given our size, given the nature of our political debate, the kind of, as they call it in Norway, facts diplomacy that works all right for them would never particularly work for us. My suspicion was always that we would blow the EEA up, or if we tried that sort of model. And I'd also say that in terms of lessons, there's a lesson in reverse, that Brexit, and this is without even thinking about Ukraine and the scale of the issues there, has brought home quite clearly the fact that the EU doesn't really have a very well-developed or effective approach for dealing with neighbours that don't want to join. And I think both sides actually have a lot of thinking to do about that. I mean, just sort of reflecting on the Brexit process, it was a process that very quickly became toxic, very quickly became political. The hope has got to be that over a medium-term horizon, both sides actually pull back a bit and think, all right, look, we're not members, but we're allies, we're partners, we're trading partners, we're collaborators. It can't be beyond the wit of man to figure out a system whereby we can work together closely without necessarily trampling over the sensitivities of either side. But I suspect at the point we're at now, we'll need that sort of cooling off period and a passage of time before we're able to have that kind of rational, cold, calm discussion about it.
Yeah, that's really useful insight. Joel, do you have any perspective on that?
Yeah, I think this is an unprecedented situation in terms of the UK lying on the EU's doorstep. Like Anan says, there's it's kind of, you know, it's not normal to have a country which isn't, you know, to some extent part of the orbit. That's, you know, fundamentally the UK is trying to compete with the EU in a lot of areas, and it exists right next door, and that's not something that's really happened before. And so it's hard to draw lessons from, you know, to apply to such a novel scenario. But what I would say is, as a wider reflection in terms of thinking about where the relationship might go, is that the EU thinks about regulating in a very specific way, which is that it thinks about consolidation between member states, you know, policies that can apply across all, even if they're not perfect, something like common agricultural policy. And it also thinks about consolidation in terms of preventing from external threats and, you know, augmenting the power of the EU internationally. A lot of what it's doing right now around digital markets, around production of microchips, around regulation of platform companies is all about this idea of digital sovereignty and making the EU, you know, less dependent or giving less power to global, often American corporations in the EU market. And so this is a way of regulation that's about control, it's about protection. You might even say, in some extent, protectionism. And the UK is, you know, isn't encumbered by those same ways of thinking. And this is, you know, going to be the interesting thing for the UK in the next 5-10 years, is can it fundamentally rethink how it does regulation? Because we're inheriting a model that's about control, and we might want to move to a model that's more about innovation, more about getting ahead emerging sectors. And there's no you know, example to follow on the EU's doorstep at the moment, and that's what makes it more difficult.
Yeah, and that means that governments have to think ahead, plan ahead, and be much more strategic. And as you've observed, year six in from leaving, we're not at that point yet. So it was interesting getting your take on different future governments, Professor Menon, on what they might do, and that alignment issue about choosing to align on most issues and then potentially innovating in areas where you're prepared to put subsidy, government investment. Gave the example to Maurice about solar panels. Presumably you could also do other renewables investment as well. But you have to be strategic and think long ahead, and presumably put chunks of central government money in to actually kick it off.
Think about, there is the cost of, there are two sorts of non-aligned costs to think about. I mean, there's the cost inherent in being outside the single market, which leads to the need for certain checks depending on sector to make sure that the standards work. Then there is the additional, so even if we align with the European Union in an informal way, that's to say we track what they're doing. And actually, in parentheses, one of the interesting questions, I think I noticed it on your sort of agenda for today, is how you track what the EU is doing to make sure that you're aligned is a very, very big question for all four administrations in the United Kingdom, I think. But the second question is, if you take the initiative and diverge, a second layer of costs for business is the need to comply with two sets of regulatory standards if they want to trade with the EU as well. So there are two different, sort of conceptually two different sorts of costs to be thinking about.
Yeah, that is really useful. Thanks.
Thank you. I'm looking around. I don't think there are any further questions from the committee this morning. Thank you very much for your attendance. And Professor, we'll make sure that link is circulated to the committee this morning that you put into the chat. And on that note, I'm going to suspend to allow our witnesses to change over. So thank you very much again. Welcome back, and we're moving to our second agenda item on a different topic this morning, which is our consideration of the Scottish Government's resource spending review. And we welcome to committee Diana Murray, Fellow of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, and Robbie McGee, Chair of Arts, Culture, Health and Wellbeing Scotland. Can I welcome you both to the meeting? We're going to move straight to questions due to time constraints, and can ask that witnesses do consider being concise if possible, given the time today. Can I ask, Mr. McGee, first of all, you say in your submission that the barriers to realising the wider benefits of culture are not just financial, and you call for cultural shift to ensure health practitioners, teachers and the wider public sector are aware of the benefits of cross-portfolio approach. How do we bring about that culture shift?
Hey, thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation to speak to the committee. Yeah, I think it's a big question, but it is about that idea of joint working and divisions within the Scottish Government working together collaboratively to reach shared objectives and outcomes. I mean, I think the quote you made about health practitioners, the cultural sector and the wider public sector, but also the wider public, need to get a better understanding of how arts, culture and health collaborations really have a positive impact on people's life, particularly people in hospital or people in with mental health issues. So I think it's important to try and get that collaborative working going across departments and see if there's ways of kind of breaking down those traditional models of working and working in a new way, which allows for more innovative, I don't know if that's the right word, but innovative approaches to try and to reach more people. Because I think from the conversations I've had with people in health, is they're always really, really positive and really want this work in their area, which whether they're in a hospital in the community or wherever they're working, they can see the benefits of cultural interventions to their patients or participants. But it's quite difficult to get that in a more kind of formulated structure, which allows that to be parity of services across Scotland and different regions, because a lot of it is centrally based at the moment, and geographically it's not equal what people can access. So there's lots of challenges, but I think there's so many practical ways that it could be done in terms of setting up particular steering groups or working groups to look at how we can make this a more equal area of practice, this cultural health area of work, and how collaborating and joint working can reach as many people as possible. I mean, it isn't rocket science. It's just, I think, there's quite traditional ways of working and people can be quite fixed in their pattern of working. And that's true of everybody. That's true of culture and that's true of health. But if there was ways of trying to break down those traditional ways of working, get people working together, I just think there's sometimes there does need to be some kind of intermediary kind of practical step taking for these areas, culture and health, at a policy level as well as an implementation level, to start talking to each other and meeting and moving this area of practice forward.
Thank you. And Ms. Murray, your point to the well-established research base showing that participation in culture can provide several wellbeing and social benefits at individual, community and national level. So coming out of COVID and with the challenges that we're all facing, how ready are we to adopt that research and realise those benefits?
I think we're more than ready to go. I think the thing that is holding people back is the funding issue and knowing whether they've got consistent funding or not. We've done quite a lot of stakeholder mapping. I'm also the chair of Arts and Business Scotland, and that organisation has done quite a lot of stakeholder mapping to find out what the barriers are to people moving forward. The consistency of funding is one. If you've got consistency of funding, you can then draw in other funding sources from trusts, foundations, businesses, and so on. Without that knowledge that you're actually going to be there next year, it's very difficult to do that. So that foundation is really important. I also think we've been doing quite a lot in that stakeholder mapping work. There are a lot of organisations, particularly community-based organisations, that are very keen to get going. What's holding them back is we were just hearing about is actually how to go about it. They've got programmes of work they want to do. They have there's plenty of evidence that their work will be helpful in the health sector, in community development, in regeneration, and all of those kind of things. But actually, who do they partner with, and how do they break down those barriers of the people they want to work with? And I think, in addition to that consistency of funding, one of the most important things is to help them create networks and to get the networking going at local level and at national level, so that we can understand where organisations that already exist and programmes that already exist and extremely good projects that already exist can actually be most effective.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from the committee and can invite first Mr Golden, please.
Thank you, convener. Perhaps I'll start with Robbie, and it was very interesting written evidence that you provided around the mapping of arts and health provision. And I'm particularly interested around the suggestion that this provision is clustered around Glasgow, Edinburgh and the Central Belt. And I just wondered your thoughts on how that provision could be expanded beyond the Central Belt, or whether it's a case that there is activity going on that's perhaps not been included in the mapping exercise.
I mean, I think what's been included in the mapping exercise is funding from organisations that are funded through Creative Scotland. So it excludes quite a lot of organisations who are getting their funding from the NHS, local authorities or other funding bodies. So I would imagine, I know that there's a lot of work, a huge amount of work going out with the Central Belt, but it's not it's not been included in this mapping exercise. But I think on the broader point, I think what's missing to kind of, I think this mapping exercise is really valuable because it does, what's been missing has been a benchmark and has been an opportunity to look at what is going on and to see in practical terms, this is what's happening, this is where it's happening. And that's been missing in Scotland. So it's really useful to have it. But I think the next step would be to develop a joint action plan with Creative Scotland and to try and consolidate what is happening, to promote best practice, to see how that can be more equally distributed across Scotland. So there is a parity of service, and that we are trying to get a more strategic approach to this area of work, because there is now a huge evidence base, which I detailed in the paper, and there is a lot of work happening, but I do worry that it's not always equally accessible to people where you live, or just whether you've got a great project in your area. And it is a kind of spectrum of activity as well. So some people will need quite an intensive support. And there's organisations that have been working across Scotland for over 30 years who've got a huge amount of experience. And then there's other people who are going along to their voluntary drama group or music group. And that's just as valuable as well, to acknowledge how important that is in people's lives. So there is a huge spectrum of creative collaborations across Scotland, but what is missing is maybe some strategic business plan or action plan to identify a vision and aims and objectives, and this is where we want to get to over the next 3 years for this area of practice.
Thanks.
I think that would be really useful.
Yeah, thanks, Robbie. And I guess, as you've highlighted, there's almost two phases to this. The first phase is establishing what provision is out there and understanding where gaps might be, and then the second phase would be looking at attempting to ensure that throughout Scotland the provision is as consistent as we can possibly make it. I just wonder, in terms of what intervention would you like to see by the Scottish Government or Creative Scotland to allow that, or both of those phases, to be enacted?
I mean, I think the more radical intervention is to look at funding from not just Creative Scotland having resources to fund organisations, but from broader portfolios, from health portfolios that can support organisations, because there is a limited amount of funding. And there is, as I said, there's more established organisations who are delivering work who, if they had a core or flexible funding approach which secured them for more 3 to 5 years, then obviously, like any area of work, that's going to secure more benefits to your participants, to the public, to patients or people who are working with those organisations. So I think securing those organisations' infrastructure and long-term funding is a really important aspect. But also other initiatives like the social prescribing area of work, which is a huge developing area, maybe a special fund or additional fund which looks at social prescribing across Scotland and funds organisations across Scotland to deliver this model of social prescribing. And then that would give a more longer term perspective on the quality of work and what's happening where across Scotland. So there's focusing on particular areas like social prescribing, but there's also investing in these organisations which are less likely than your other mainstream cultural organisations to receive full-time funding, but long-term funding.
Thank you, Robbie. And Diana, I just wonder your thoughts on how we, one, improve our understanding and mapping of this, as well as help to enhance our provision.
I think we've done a lot already, as Robbie was saying. I think the exercise that Creative Scotland did is a very useful one, and I think it would be useful to extend that to include more of those that are not funded by Creative Scotland, because, as he says, there's a lot going on. And as I said, Arts and Business has done quite a lot of stakeholder mapping through its membership and those who are willing to partake in surveys. And that's a very good way of finding out what's actually going on. That's the first step. I would just like to draw a slight parallel with the work that we've done with businesses, because businesses are very pleased to help and get involved with culture, but they have to make a business case, usually, to their organisation before they will fund anything. It's not just a case of, you know, philanthropy. It's often, you know, a hard business case. And I think the same thing would apply to if you're going to use money from other departments, like the health department. You can't just expect them to allocate an amount of money because it's a nice idea, or even if they can see the benefits, they have to make a proper business case for it. So I think we're going to have to work harder at working, at networking and working with the health service and with other parts of government to demonstrate the benefit of using arts and culture in their departments, that it's a benefit to them, that there's a business benefit to them, that it will enhance their work or save them money in other ways. For example, with mental health, it's really difficult to quantify, but there are certainly a huge amount of mental health and well-being avoidance, I would say, avoidance of mental health issues and encouraging well-being issues, which are really hard to measure, by people joining local arts groups, being part of voluntary arts organisations and so on. Difficult to measure that and ask the health service to fund that, but by working together with them, I think, and on the networking basis, we could actually partner places up and demonstrate them making a business case is possible.
Thank you. That was very interesting. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Ms. Mintle?
Convener, and thank you, panel, and thank you for your submissions too. I'm interested just to perhaps expand a bit more on Mr. Golden's questions around about social prescribing. I've got a friend who's a retired doctor, and that's something that he would have loved to have been able to do. But I suppose there is perhaps a perception from some people that you go to the doctor and you expect to get pills or a bandage or something, and perhaps social prescribing, there's a way to go to make that more acceptable, perhaps. So I'm just interested to know how, the work perhaps that you've done, Robbie, or your organisations that have tried to change people's perception of that and how that's been achieved, or if you've got any examples from other countries perhaps that are doing this and how we can move, change what happens in Scotland.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think it's a great question. I think the public perception is key, and I think that's often forgotten about in this area of work because it's such a new area of work that I don't think there is a huge understanding in the wider public about the role of culture and creative collaborations and how they can be really beneficial to your mental health. I think in some ways they're just intrinsic, so people do them and that helps, but it's not necessarily as spelled out or as clear to the public as some people think. So I know that there is really strong social prescribing work happening in Scotland with the development of the new Community Link workers, and there is within NHS Lothian and other NHS boards across Scotland trying for the Community Link workers to work very proactively to look at the cultural activity that's happening in the local community and trying to get people who are hard to reach or housebound or not really engaging in their wider community to access through the Community Link workers cultural activity that's happening in their community. And I've been doing this job a long time, and previously, about 10 years ago, I did a report with what was then the Mental Health Foundation on the benefits of social prescribing, and at the time, they were looking at how it could, people who were being prescribed antidepressants, how as an alternative, if you were prescribed to a cultural or creative engagement, how that would work. And it was a very small study, but it's interesting that after 10 years on, it's still not managed to secure a more kind of strategic, broader, like sport referral is quite established, and that is within GP practices and within healthcare settings. But cultural referral has still got a long way to go to reach that same stage. But in England, they have built up quite a strong social prescribing model, and they have put quite a lot of resources into it, and that's in its first year of its development. And it is interesting; it is looking very much from healthcare, primary healthcare, referring people who are coming to the surgery, coming to see their healthcare professional, and referring them to cultural activity. The big elephant in the room is the resources and the funding, and how you measure and how you guarantee that if you're referring who somebody who could be actually quite vulnerable or who could be a wee bit anxious or could be not confident about going to an activity, you're sending them to an activity. Have you done the research? Do health have the time to look, do the research into that provision? And do culture have the resources to provide the provision? And then there's the other argument that you can overthink it, because actually people can be quite resourceful and they can go to an activity that's happening in their community and really benefit from it. But I do think there is that kind of, you do have to be careful as well that if you're doing this work, you need to think about the whole picture and kind of trying to resource the activity properly and provide a pathway for the person that's going to be positive for them as well. So I think there is some guidelines being written up and developed from various projects across Scotland, and there is a new social prescribing network in Scotland, and it's purely coming, it's mostly from a health perspective, and they are looking how they can refer their patients and people who use their services to cultural activities. And there's a really strong one in Inverclyde, which is a really strong cultural social prescribing network coming through primary health. So it's a developing area, but again, it's that thing, is it would be great if you could pull all these projects that are happening in Scotland together so you could get more of an understanding of what's happening and how you can make this more a palliative service so that it becomes more integrated into NHS and healthcare so that everybody can access it. And I think that's where we are. How do we kind of integrate social prescribing more strategically into healthcare in Scotland? And there is a model that they've kind of done that in England. I've started that the first year, where they've kind of strategically integrated social prescribing into NHS England.
Thank you, Robbie. Diana, do you have anything to add?
Not really. That all sounds very sensible to me. I'd just come back to this networking point that, bringing together the people who are doing this already encourages other people to just take the step and to do it. So there's nothing better than example to persuade other people that this is a good way forward.
Yeah, I recognise that in my own constituency of Argyll and Bute, and also the word of mouth is very important. If someone sees a benefit, then they might take someone else along that can also get the benefit. However, I'm also very aware that one size doesn't fit all, and what works on one island might not work on another island. So it's an interesting conundrum. Changing the topic ever so slightly, last night I was at a cross-party group on the creative economy, and we got some fantastic presentations from individuals and organisations from the gaming industry, and how they were working across different areas, not only the likes of Minecraft, but also from a health perspective and an education perspective. And I'm just interested to hear, Robbie, what work have you done with the gaming industry? And Diana, I suppose, what research have you done bringing that area of our economy, which is also part of our culture side as well? Robbie.
I mean, it's a really exciting area. We did run an event, which an online event due to COVID, for young people and mental health, and how culture and creativity can support young people's mental health. And ArtLink Edinburgh did a presentation on the work that they're doing with young people, and it was around the idea of designing a game and a comic, and it was really quite innovative the way they were approaching it. And I think it's maybe a bit obvious, but for me, that's where there is a lot of interest in the gaming and cultural economy and things in the younger, reaching younger people who are often sometimes quite difficult to reach. And there obviously is huge issues around self-harm and mental health issues with young people. And it seems to be that gaming can be a way of bringing young people in. And within the arts and health context, it isn't actually particularly well established, that area of practice and working in that way, but it is a developing area. And the experience I've got is that it's younger people who are accessing the arts and health through the bringing in through the game, the gaming, like, as you mentioned, like Minecraft and all these different things. So it would be interesting to see how that could develop more. It isn't a huge thing that we have been working with within this network, but I think it's something that is developing. And my experience of it was when we ran an event for young people in mental health, and it was really quite a big part of that event.
Yeah, I've dropped a wee pebble there, and you can do some more work on that. Great. Diana?
I have less knowledge about the health benefits, although I can see that very clearly. One of the points we made in our presentation is that there really needs to be investment in skills development and training right across the board, particularly in, the creative industries, of course, have it in spades, but across the rest of arts and culture, because there's a lot that can be delivered digitally. I can think of a programme that was delivered in the Western Isles, which was a web-based memory programme, so that people could take part in it, even though they were dispersed communities. And that was very successful. So I think there's a lot that digital skills can offer. And I think a lot of what we're talking about can come down to better training, better involvement of skills development. I think making sure that we build arts, culture and these digital skills in at young education level in schools is really important, because that helps people take part in a lot of these activities.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Convener. You mentioned, Ms. Murray, about the how it can be hard to measure the benefits of these interventions in terms of culture and health. Although we all know the benefits are there. I just wondered if either of you wanted to say anything about evidence perhaps from other countries. I realise that there's very recent work perhaps been done, you mentioned, in England, but more generally I wondered if there was anything that you could say about evidence from other countries that might be offered up to help make that business case that you describe about the benefits of perhaps prescribing cultural activities or indeed closer working between, in terms of budget, between cultural and health organisations.
I haven't got any evidence I can bring to you, I'm afraid, that I can immediately think of. I don't know if Robbie has.
Yeah, I mean, there's a 2019 review by the World Health Organization, which looked at over 3,000 studies and identified a major role for the arts in the prevention of ill health, promotion of health, and management and treatment of illness across the lifespan. So that was a major piece of work, and they did a presentation in Sweden, and it was brilliant because it was the world. So it was like the world is doing all this work in arts and health. And we have a good contact in Nigeria with arts and medicine in Nigeria, which is a global, it started in Nigeria, but which is now a global organisation which is delivering work across the world to support collaborations between health and culture. And often it's looking at health inequalities and how joint working can be shown. So they kind of they fund projects for a year, and then they showcase the collaborations between health promotion and health and culture, and what they achieve in that year to illustrate how these collaborations can work and to show them globally. So there is a lot of research happened, and there's been quite a lot of research by the all party parliamentary group and the Creative Health Report. The Creative Health and Report in 2017 was a huge, it was almost like a Bible for arts and health, because it did kind of go into real detail and kind of focus a lot on the evidence base for this work. And there's been quite a lot of work done during COVID. I've listed it in the paper, which is a research of art, cultural and health collaborations during COVID and the impact they have had, and how post-COVID, how that work needs to be developed, because the impact on people's mental health and the increase in isolation and loneliness and the impacts of COVID, the role of culture and health, creative collaborations could be really beneficial post-COVID as we try to recover from the pandemic. So there's a lot of evidence out there which is clearly showing the benefits of creative collaborations on people's health and well-being.
I suppose finally, all I really wanted to say on the back of that was that clearly the evidence is there from what you've just described, Robbie, but on the other hand, it's been pointed out by Diana Murray that sometimes it's a struggle to assemble evidence that actually makes a business case. So what can be done to marshal that international evidence in a form that is going to convince health boards and Creative Scotland and everyone else about the need for closer working?
I really think that, I know this may sound counterintuitive, but I think we have to put a financial value on that. And that is, this is why I say it's quite hard to measure the preventative value, preventative outcome. What are you preventing happening? And if you can put a financial value on that, the cost to the health service by actually investing in these activities, then I think it makes sense to the people who make the decisions about where the money goes in the health service and elsewhere. Because while the health professionals can see the value of it, actually trying to argue that money should be allocated to this kind of activity is a different situation altogether. So I don't know how we do that, but I do think it might be worth developing up a model to do that. There are certainly one of the ways of doing it to a certain extent is to do some impact assessments, and I've mentioned at least one of those relating to the events industry in the paper that we submitted from the Royal Society, but I expect Robbie's got other examples of that too.
The impact, increasingly recognised internationally, is the social prescribing model. That has got an international kind of momentum, and there is a lot of research around that, and that is a kind of commonality happening across the world that people are trying to implement a social prescribing model. But I think also, if you're particularly looking at particular areas in medicine or health, then if you focus on those areas, then you can look at the research that supports the development of work in those areas, like the recovery from mental illness after trauma, improving experience of hospital inpatients, improving social connections between staff and residents in care homes, and the benefits of culture activity on people who are living with dementia. There's a lot of research in those areas, and I think a lot of people can use the research particular to those areas as well when they're looking for resources from the NHS or broader funders out with the cultural funders, but also with the cultural funders require that evidence base as well. So I think there is lots of evidence out there, but I think, as you say, it's how you kind of relate that to your applications and getting resources and funding to support the work. But it is now much better than it used to be, the evidence base, and we have got all the evidence on our website. Our network has all the new evidence that comes out, and we put that on our website, so it's accessible to everybody. But as I say now, there is a huge evidence base for this work, and I think a lot of people do kind of now look out the areas of research which will support particular projects in particular areas of medicine.
Thank you. Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much. And can I thank both the witnesses for the fantastic paperwork you've sent us in advance, which very much tunes in with what we've been discussing. I mean, on the one hand, we've had the evidence from Creative Scotland that says that key parts of the cultural sector risk collapse post-COVID. You've got the decade of cuts to local authorities, which impacts on community culture, and that's massively impacted because it's not a core funding. But then we've got the evidence you're giving us about preventative impact of spending on culture. Jenny talked about the CPG this week, culture and the business sector. We've had the culture and communities evidence, all of which aligns with your evidence today, which tells us that it makes economic, financial and human sense to invest in social prescribing. So how do we do this? We're a committee giving recommendations to the government, but it feels like this should be part of a fast-track COVID recovery, because if you think about young people, mental health, they can't get that support, and yet social prescribing potentially would get people back on track and not have to miss years of progress in their lives. So what are the triggers? We've got the budget, but what are the triggers, do you think, to actually lift this up? Because we'll all agree that preventative spending makes sense, but as you've just observed, Robbie, some of this research has been out there for over a decade, and Campbell Christie's recommendations were a decade ago. What is our trigger that would actually help us come out of COVID and get on the right track, do you think? What would you recommend? Maybe take Robbie first and then move on to Diana.
When I was thinking about this, I had noted down in my paper, but it does relate to the funding, about the kind of securing the funding for organisations who've been working in this area for a long period of time, so they can kind of secure their funding base and develop programmes that are secure for 3 to 5 years. I mean, it sounds quite basic, but historically, arts and culture and health has been the kind of poor. It doesn't necessarily fit into your clear kind of equalities framework of different equalities priorities. So sometimes it's difficult for art, culture and health organisations to get that longer term support. But I suppose as well it's about the how you kind of make it more an understanding of this area of work within the wider public, as well as the kind of area, this area of practice where people know it's good and know it's work, but trying to increase the understanding within the wider public. And I think from that you get a more momentum to try and make sure that this work is recognised and valued. But I mean, just from my own personal experience, at the moment I'm working with a consultant in renal medicine, and the patients that she's been working with have had such a hard time during the last 2 years. Some of them have been vaccine resistant, and it's all been very traumatic. And we're trying to develop an ARTS programme for those patients post-COVID. So I can see the value of this work, and it's not just a kind of soft value. It's actually quite a fundamental value to patients, families and staff. And I don't say that lightly, because I know you can make broad brush strokes about culture, but I do think there is a kind of intrinsic value in integrating this into mainstream health care, so that there is an option for people to look at the person and the quality of that person's life within our care structures. And I know that is a lot of people are thinking about that post-COVID. It's not just about the medical provision, it's also about the personal quality of life aspect of your care. And I do think that culture can play a huge part in that. So I wonder if there's a job to be done in trying to articulate the value of this work to patient staff and their families, to try and make that more integral into health. Because at the moment, it is quite bitty. It is certain health boards are funding certain projects and certain priorities are being funded. But I think if there was a national strategy and we could get the health and culture working together to really invest in this and say, post-COVID, we want this to be an intrinsic part of both those areas and we can work together to make that happen, then I think that would be a really positive thing. I don't know if that's just kind of idealistic, but I do think if there was a way that both health and culture could work together, really strategically, based on the work on the ground, obviously coming up from what's happening on the ground. But then I think what's happening at the moment is there's great work happening, brilliant work happening in Scotland. I would argue, because I've seen a lot of the work happening, I would argue that the work happening in Scotland is so valuable and so strong, but I don't think Scotland is necessarily best at promoting that and saying that and saying we are actually world leaders in this area of practice. And I just wonder if there's a way of culture and health working collaboratively to make it more integrated into the health service.
That's a really useful insight. I mean, maybe like a kickstart fund just to get things going, and then think about that three-year funding that you're talking about to actually enable longer-term investment and make sure you've picked up issues about care and safeguarding, particularly if it's people with mental health issues, to make sure you're not making them more vulnerable. Thanks for that. It's really useful. Yeah. Diana, do you have any insight on this as to how we'd actually make this happen and kick it off?
Well, yes, I do. And I'm going to look at it from a different angle. I mean, that's all valid, and I wouldn't, this isn't an either or. But looking at it from the other angle, we want to actually catch people before they get into the health system. And there are some fantastic community arts organisations and arts projects that are out there. And I know that, you know, every time you talk to them, they're really struggling for cash, and what they really need is the consistency of funding. Now, they're mostly organisations that Creative Scotland is aware of, and also that local authorities are aware of. But what they actually need is that consistent funding. If they get that three-year funding commitment, then they can go out and do work out projects, get funding for those projects, work with businesses or work with trusts and foundations, or find ways of earning money themselves. So they need that consistent funding. I'll just give you one example. I was on the panel looking at the awards for the SURF, the Scottish Urban Regeneration Fund. I went to see, as part of that, I went to see some fantastic projects, but one of them was the Whale project in Wester Hales, you know, it's a deprived area of Edinburgh. they, on a shoestring, they were doing projects for young people, arts projects, plays, bringing people were coming through the door all the time. Older people were coming in and doing crafting sessions, creative crafting, but the point was that they were talking to each other. And they also had a shed in the garden where some men came to just communicate with one another and drink cups of tea. But they were also doing art projects at the same time. That sort of that is replicated all over Scotland, and it's different in different areas. And as I said, in the Western Isles, I came across a project which was a web-based one, which involved people being able to take part from their own homes. All of these things are mostly they're known to Creative Scotland. If we could get the funding consistently into those really good community arts projects, then you actually have a preventative effect on people's mental health, on people's socialization, and a number of other things, including dementia, you know, allowing people to stay in their own home but taking part in some of these activities. And I think they're the areas that have been so badly hit by the pandemic, by local authority funding, which has been really stretched, and by the, you know, the central funding, which is also stretched. So that's where I would focus from a preventative point of view. But that's the area where I think the outcomes are difficult to measure, because they're preventative outcomes rather than the ones that you might get directly.
That's very useful. And in a way, actually, we probably need to do both, because that prevention going forward is as critical as supporting people once they've had a crisis or an incident. If I can draw colleagues' attention to, there was a really good report published this week which highlights the work of the Whale Project, and it was about mapping cultural dispersal done by the Edinburgh Festivals. I think it's a point that was made earlier about spreading investment across, so it's not just Edinburgh and Glasgow, but even within Edinburgh and Glasgow, the social barriers to access to culture are really huge. So I very much think that the evidence we've just had is something we need to pick up going forwards, convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Ruskell?
Yeah, thanks very much. I'm just thinking about some of the points you've been making this morning, and particularly some of the kind of creativity that we're seeing in communities, the way that projects get set up, you know, their history, their kind of diversity. Does that make it difficult then in terms of mainstreaming, in terms of taking a particular model that you can then take to every health board across the country and say, okay, this is what projects deliver, this is how we're going to employ consistent monitoring and evaluation, this is how we're going to develop some of the assessments of how you make financial savings. I mean, is there a difficulty here in taking what is perhaps quite a grassroots movement, grassroots projects, and then trying to interface that with perhaps some of the harder objectives and systems that the NHS will have, or health and social care partnerships, or you know, community planning partnerships, or whatever? So how do we sort of get that creativity within communities interfacing with those that have actually got the money in a way that can deliver the objectives in a consistent way? Robbie, do you want to start off from the perspective of your projects and how they've managed to negotiate that?
I think it's a really broad spectrum of organisations within communities. So if you were looking at health boards areas, you can actually map that there probably is an organisation who has been in existence for a relative long period of time and probably would fit into the long-term funding model within that local authority. And then there is other organisations, as you say, who are more grassroots, and there is a strong movement in Scotland about supporting voluntary community organisations within this area of practice as well, because it's quite there's a political aspect to that as well, in the sense that these organisations are proud of their community and voluntary status, and that's the perspective they're coming from. But I think you can have a kind of a tapestry of all these organisations within the different health boards, and then you can design a kind of art strategy within that health board, which draws on all your resources within your community that actually your members of your community could really benefit from and work with. So I think if you were to map the cultural organisations and activity within each health board, you would actually find a lot of resources that your health board can draw on. And then the piece of work is kind of designing your strategy around, as you say, the financial benefits of using this resource in your community. And the most important thing, the benefit to your, whether it's your patients in your hospitals, your residents in your care homes, your members of your community who are housebound and not accessing any community services, if people work together, because we've got examples of all those things that work brilliantly in different parts of Scotland, if there was a way that we could work with health boards, kind of design a strategy which draws on that resource, then I think that would be really positive. But you're right, there is quite a piece of work to be done in kind of mapping that and kind of coordinating that and kind of facilitating that. But I am a firm believer, because I do think, having worked in this area a lot, practically doing stuff is really good, rather than just trying to make the perfect scenario and design that, because it generally does come from the organisations themselves, the best approach. And if you can take that to the health boards or take that to the funding bodies and say, this is what exists already, rather than to reinvent anything, I really don't think there is a necessity to reinvent anything. I think it's all there. I just think it needs joined up, and there needs to be funding for organisations with the longer term, and there needs to be a fund to support organisations coming in for project funding. And there could be a development that you come in for project funding and that leads to permanent funding in 3 or 4 years once you're more developed. So that kind of structure, I think, could work really well. But I do think that the organisations and the artists and the community workers and the volunteers, they're all out there. It's just how you coordinate that.
Yeah. And I suppose what I'm asking here is there a need for that consistency? I mean, you mentioned Inverclyde earlier on as an exemplar, but you know, do you think there needs to be guidance to all health boards to do this, or is this the responsibility of community planning partnerships, or like, should there be some expectation on authorities to be doing this mapping work and evolving this work?
I mean, it is difficult because health boards have different priorities and health boards have different areas of interest. There was a kind of directorate, wasn't there, on public health, a new build, that there was a percentage of that capital needed to be put into art. So any new health building needed to have a percentage for art within that. But sometimes when you make it so kind of directive and so prescriptive, that kind of can have a negative impact as well. So it's trying to find a balance where actually health boards want to do this because they can see the benefits to their communities. And generally that's what health boards want. So I suppose I think it's about designing a strategy over a 3 to 5 year period and trying to engage with all the health boards across Scotland to buy into that strategy, that they will look at their cultural strategy and see how that can be implemented. And we can provide all the examples of kind of best practice or work that's happening in different health boards across Scotland. And if there is a need to kind of join that up, because there is a lot of networks. There's a social prescribing network, there's the community arts network, there's different networks across Scotland who you would bring into that conversation and try and make it as an inclusive conversation as possible, so that it becomes a really dynamic and positive thing. Because I think from the case studies that are listed in the paper, there is so much diversity in the work that museums are doing, the work that galleries are doing, the work that particular arts and health specific organisations are doing, and then work that community organisations are doing who wouldn't necessarily label themselves as arts and health organisations, but they're having a really positive impact on their community's health. and then health organisations who are delivering culture as part of their work as well. So there's a broad range of organisations engaging in this work.
See a fuzziness between the boundaries of what certain projects are doing, and they may be delivering objectives across different areas. Diana, can I ask for your reflections on that?
I think the strategic approach is probably helpful. I think it's important that we're not too prescriptive about it, as Ravi says, because the thing about culture and indeed heritage comes into this to some extent as well, is it can offer that kind of support to the health agenda in all sorts of different ways. And if we start being prescriptive about it, then it probably won't be very effective, and also will take up a huge amount of resource which could be used elsewhere. There is a lot out there, as Robbie says, already, that just needs to be harnessed into the right direction. I think a strategy is a good idea. I would agree with that. But I'll go back to my networking point. The more we can actually get people to network together, and there are networks out there where the benefits of this kind of activity can be promoted and developed and example shown. There's nothing better than an example for other people to say, oh, we could do that and we could reap the benefits as well. I think that's a good way to do it. The question is, how do you do that? We do have organisations like Creative Scotland and Historic Environment Scotland, Arts and Business Scotland and Robbie's organisation who could use their experience to put something like this in place and make it more sort of Scotland-wide than it perhaps is at the moment. But there's a lot of experience there, and a lot of it's just to bring it all together and show the benefit of it.
Yeah, I think particularly areas like monitoring and evaluation of projects, you know, trying to share that understanding about how to do that. Just a final question, it's a bigger one really. It's about the government's got a wellbeing economy bill slated to be brought forward in this session of Parliament. I'm wondering if you've got any thoughts at that kind of higher level of governance in Scotland about, you know, what could be in that bill that would help to support these kind of initiatives. Is it about having the right kind of indicator? Is it about having a commissioner that can look at the needs of future generations? I mean, what do you think that thing is that would be useful in the bill at a legislative level that would help to drive progress in this area and ensure that we're not forgetting about this work and we're prioritising it? Don't worry if you don't have an answer to that, because there's time for you to feed that into the government consultations, I think, but interesting to know if you've got any top lines.
It goes a bit too far to read it at the moment, Mark. Okay. I'm conscious we may not even get the bill for this committee. So right. I think if you don't mind, I think if you want to follow up in writing with an answer to that, I'd be more than happy. I'm conscious of time as well, so I'm going to move to Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you both. I'd like to talk about public service reform. One of the suggestions made in the Scottish Government's review framework document is that the government says that they're going to examine discrete opportunities for longer-term, large-scale public service reform. And clearly there's a funding element to that and how we fund culture, but there's also an organisational element to that. And I just wondered if either of you had any observations about the funding structures for culture, but also the organisational structures, the agencies that work, the role of local authorities. Robbie, I noticed that in your submission, you talk about perhaps a more radical change of core funding to cultural organisations from outside the culture portfolio and a project funding approach. And I just wondered if you could develop that, please. So perhaps Robbie, followed by Diana.
Yeah, I think it's interesting because the work that we are doing does cross over health and culture, obviously. And if the funding model is looking at indicators in relation to health outcomes and people's increase in self-esteem, confidence, well-being, if those indicators are being achieved through the cultural intervention, I just wondered whether out with the cultural portfolio, then that there would be opportunities for public health resources to be funding cultural organisations who are delivering on health outcomes. So I suppose the radical idea was that the contribution that culture makes to the outcomes of the National Performance Network could be recognised by providing fixed-term funding to organisations which are crossing the health and cultural fields. In terms of the structure of funding, at the moment, Creative Scotland have been very supportive of our network and provided funding for the first year and are providing funding for the second year. And we have a good relationship with them in terms of their advice and support. But within what I think historically within Creative Scotland, there hasn't been a particular focus on arts and health as a strategic area of development. And I think that is now changing, and I think that's a really positive thing, because I think it's always never quite fitted into a particular area within Creative Scotland. And if it is that there is going to be a focus on arts and health, culture and health within Creative Scotland strategically, that is definitely a really positive thing. And that is certainly the conversations I've had, that is the road that Creative Scotland are going to be focusing more on arts and health as a strategic area, which should hopefully mean that organisations, because there isn't any core funded arts and health organisations in Scotland, and that is very unusual compared to England, whereas about 10 to 15% of the organisations who receive core funding are arts and health organisations. So within that already, our infrastructure and capacity to develop as a sector is limited. Another point is that there is NHS boards which are funding cultural organisations, and that is a really, really positive thing. And I think, again, that's something that we need to look at, and how that works and how that is achieved. And there's also other areas within the NHS that are funding cultural activity purely for the health outcome benefits to their. So again, articulating that and sharing that across other organisations and other, making that more understandable how that works would be beneficial. But for me, in a very simple term, the funding structure would be to fund organisations who've been working in this area for a long period of time and have the expertise and knowledge on a fixed core funding basis, and organisations who are developing and looking to come into this area of work or for specialised projects around social prescribing and stuff, they could be funded on a shorter term funding process with the trajectory that they could apply for core funding as they develop. And if it was possible, in an ideal scenario, that would be accessible through public through health public health. It wouldn't just be through cultural, wouldn't just be through Creative Scotland, it would be through, as you said in your question, it would be accessible through different areas of funding within the public spending. So you could apply for a cultural project, not just to a cultural funder, but to other areas of public funding.
Thank you. Diana?
Well, I mean, we acknowledge that culture is a major part of all sorts of things in this country, tourism, the Scottish identity, and we're talking today specifically about its contribution to the health of the nation. And yet we are, the amount of money identified for cultural work is really tiny compared with the rest of the government funding. I'm quite sure that it's not going to be increased, but I do think we need to recognise that, and that amount of money goes a very long way already. We do have major funding organisations, and sometimes one feels that they don't necessarily work together. So we've got Creative Scotland, obviously. We've also got Historic Environment Scotland. And we've also got the Heritage Lottery, sorry, the Lottery Fund Heritage money as well. And sometimes we find that organisations have to apply to all three and do different funding applications to all three with different emphasis. And you also find we're so used in the cultural sector to having everything project funded, constantly trying to think of new projects, because some of these funders won't fund projects to be repeated, even if they're really, really good. So I think all of that needs to be looked at. It's probably out with this committee's remit, but I do think there are issues there. And often organisations, big and small, rely on project funding and at the expense of having a core, which allows them to really develop. I should mention, I think that with my arts and business hat on, we are trying to encourage businesses to invest much more in culture. And at the moment, we're getting about a 1.2 return on investment for businesses investing in culture with match funding from the Culture and Business Fund Scotland, which is provided by government. Has been an enormous take up this year of businesses wanting to be involved with culture, partly because of the new environmental, social and governance feeling about businesses, where they want staff to staff well-being and staff working with a purpose is much more important these days. They find that having involvement with culture is really good for the well-being of their staff. So it's not just, in the health sectors we've been talking about, but also in businesses where, staff have been suffering from well-being issues. We could easily double the amount that we give out our Cultural Business Fund Scotland and get more than double the amount back from business at the moment. So I think that's a whole area that needs perhaps we're looking at again, not necessarily on the, directly on the narrow area of health and well-being we're looking at, but perhaps a broad area of culture spend.
Just finally, I mean, spending is and funding is plainly of immense importance, but just setting that aside. For the moment, do you have any comments to make on the sort of landscape of government agencies working in the cultural sector and any kind of reform that you might want to see in relation to what the Scottish Government suggests about public service reform? Perhaps Diana, quickly followed by Robbie.
Well, I do agree with the aim of trying to get culture right through all the government departments. And I think, the siloisation of government, it's much better than it used to be, I have to say, but it's still there. So sort of education as well is another area where you'd think that it was well established, but it's not as good as it could be, as well as health and social issues. There's the whole international aspect of this as well. I mean, our cultural activities are really very important I'm sorry, I'm thinking off the top of my head because it's not an area I sort of prepared for, but those are just things I could think of immediately.
Robbie?
I mean, I have worked for Creative Scotland, a local authority, and the health board. And I think actually all of them are doing brilliant work, but they do kind of operate sometimes in their own bubbles. And in some ways, if there was a way, which I know would not be straightforward, but if there was a way of public services somehow working in a more collaborative way to reach shared outcomes in relation to culture, if there was a way that, and I know there is already, and I know there's models already, but just somehow if there was a more collaborative working between public sector funders to reach shared targets, I think that would be a really positive thing. And it could be quite simple, or it could be quite radical and innovative to try and make them more collaborative in relation to culture, because often local authorities health boards and like national funding bodies, they're all reaching for the same targets in relation to people's mental health and well-being in terms of their communities. So, but they can operate in isolation, and it would be, I don't know what the answer is, but if there was a way that they could work more collaboratively, that'd be a very positive thing.
Thank you both very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I think that's exhaustive questions from the committee this morning. Can I thank you very much for your attendance and also for the submissions that you gave, which have been referenced by many of the colleagues this morning. They were very, very helpful. So I'm now going to close the meeting today. Thank you very much.